the district facilities. It's exciting to me when I walk into a building and I see vision and values and purpose statement and strategic priorities. It helps people understand that we're taking this seriously. And so that's another commitment we really want the school district to take and share it. Let people know we're really gonna make this happen. And lastly, and you'll hear more about this from Chuck, but to use this plan, not just as, you know, one pager that we kind of look at monthly, but to really help it guide future decision making and resource allocation. We all know that the reality is changing. We all know that that's happening, so we're gonna have to do things differently. And we are looking forward to hearing more about it from Chuck. Thank you.
Thank you, Darcy. Good evening, everyone. So my job is to land the plane. I've heard about a lot of work that's been done, and I'm no Captain Scully, I'll tell you that right now. So we're not going to land it upside down or sideways. We're just kind of taking it nice and slow. But anyhow, you know, I too, as well as being a business owner in this community, I have a couple of daughters who attend Forest Hill School. So it's a source of pride for me, and also it's very exciting and eye-opening to see the work that goes on behind the scenes with the school district. So thank you, Mr. Peters, for allowing me to be a part of this. So basically, we're all in. And if accepted as proposed, we believe that the board should endorse the following recommendations. And based on our committee work, we came up with these recommendations. So first, all stakeholders recognize and support that a continuous recruitment mindset should exist. We must be flexible, adaptable, and reflective to ensure improved student achievement. So really, this is a student-first mentality that we want to take into consideration. We want to look at all areas of the school district and make sure that everyone has this continuous improvement mindset. Secondly, from pre-K through 12th grade, district-wide alignment is essential. We heard from some of the functional experts, some of the staff members, some of the issues or some of the opportunities that exist for alignment. Without consistent implementation, priorities and objectives within a strategic plan presented tonight, it will be difficult to achieve the excellence that we talked about and even to articulate it. So again, district-wide alignment is critical. Thirdly, quality time and effort to professionally develop the district staff is essential to meet the changing needs and demands of our students, school, and community. Highly qualified staff must be pursued, hired, trained, and retained, most importantly. So we also believe that great effort must be devoted towards the implementation of research-based, effective instructional strategies, inclusive of 21st century-based competencies and seamless technology integration. Instructional innovation also includes teacher collaboration, use of data to inform classroom strategies, and connection to building goals and district strategic planning priorities. Finally, mutual accountability, or this all-in mindset, is key. Responsibility for performance, regardless of your internal or external affiliation, is essential to meet the plan's established vision, mission, and priorities. So just to recap, those are the five recommendations that came out of our committee's work. Continuous improvement mindset, district-wide alignment, strengthening staff capacity, instructional innovation, and mutual accountability. So, thank you for your time. We're happy to take any questions. So, yes?
My son is on the spectrum of autism and Asperger's, and he was clinically diagnosed by a doctor 4 years ago, and the school district still does not acknowledge him and support him with his disability, and I was seeing how we could get that issue resolved and get the help and support we need from the Forest Hill School District.
Tell you what, let me ask the superintendent follow up after the meeting on that question directly, because I'm not sure that you all are prepared to answer a question like that. So, and at this point, let me ask if there are any questions from the board members. We'll start with to either the superintendent. Or did you have any additional comments?
I do once.
Okay.
Once you're finished speaking. Any
questions from the board? Anyone have questions? We have time for comments here in a minute.
I just want to say thanks. Thanks for all your time and effort, and you can tell. Appreciate it. Great product.
So, if I may.
Yes.
Please. I'd like to share the work now with this committee. If you have for this document, you can follow along. Is it the next slide? Please. So this plan, and you see it in front of you, if you have a copy, it has a vision for our school district, and that is trying to ensure success for all students. And when we came together, when we first started out, we had some values that we put together as a group, teachers, staff, administrators, community members, and over the time in this committee, those values sort of changed into two different levels of commitment. The first is core commitments, and this is what the committee felt were the core things that really beyond all of the things we talked about tonight just absolutely must be there, sort of the bedrock to a quality of school district. The whole child growth and development is extremely important. Fiscal responsibility, staff expertise and professional development that you heard a bit about tonight, family and community partnerships, safe and secure environments, and respect and responsibility. Those are sort of the core things that should be part of any particular strategic plan. And then the committee started to talk about, these are great, but what do we aspire to be? What do we want the district to really look like in 5 years? And then beyond that, into a 10-year time period. And that's where you get into the student-centered type learning, the more responsibility placed on the student for their own learning, and all of our processes, procedures, and instructional strategies legitimately being designed for the student in the classroom. Cultural awareness, equity, and inclusion. And cultural awareness really should be, not that this document is incorrect, but we talked with some folks who came in, it's cultural proficiency. It's having a sense of what's happening within your schools, within your classroom, the individuals that you serve, the students, the parents, the community, having a sense of what the culture is, and being proficient to be able to meet all individuals who come into our offices at the level or the desire of people who are coming in to talk with us. Family and community partnerships, that's an aspirational goal. School districts always say we want to be better involved with our community or better involved with our family and develop more partnerships. In this day, in this age of education, we're going to have to make that a primary objective. We need to have relationships with our parents, relationships with our community that go beyond the typical traditional raise money, sort of come in and volunteer. A true relationship about students and about learning and about how the school should be set up to meet the needs of students. Pursuit of high expectations. Most of the documents you see about education say high expectations, but it isn't. It's something that should be an aspiration, according to the committee, that we just continuously stretch ourselves to get to a higher level, to achieve higher success, not only as students in the classroom, but as educators who provide services. And a passionate love of learning is an aspirational value. Passionate love of learning is extremely important for students, young people, all people in this day and age, to have a passion about something, to be able to do something beyond what the expectation. And that passion is driven from an internal desire, which the school system needs to try to help mature and grow. That turned into the next part of the document where we're still on that same page, Susan. We believe learning includes, and I'm not going to read all of these to you, but these beliefs about learning that you see in the next part of the document that you have in front of you, it really does speak to our desire to transition our school district to a more student-centered, student-empowered, student-engaged place so that they can excel and achieve success at much higher levels. And these beliefs sort of articulate that in a much more specific way as you go through the document, which then brings us to what the committee believed was not our mission, our purpose, our entire purpose. So the word changed from mission to purpose during this process. And the purpose is to empower each student to achieve personal success every day. So you have the vision of striving to ensure success for all students, but the personal, everyday, on the ground, on the floor sort of work is empowering each student to achieve personal success every day in their life. Which then takes us to what used to be labeled goals, now are priorities of the school district. The next five things that are on your document are about priorities for the next 5 years, which is to prepare students for postgraduate success. And we hear more and more about that in the state of Ohio and across the nation. We want kids to aspire to go to college, to have a career after high school, to have a niche, a talent when they leave our school so that they can be successful at whatever they would like to do after high school, after they graduate. And that's important for us to think about pathways and different ways that they can learn in classrooms and to experience different types of things in the classroom. So that's important to this committee. Provide improved learning for students through job-embedded professional development for the staff. This particular committee heard loudly and believes that professional development is extremely important as we transition our school district into what this document suggests it should be. And to do that, it takes time, it takes collaboration, and it takes resources. They understand that, and they wanted that to be maintained in this document. Safe, secure, and inclusive culture. It's not only about cameras and locks on doors, it's about an environment, it's about a mindset, it's about a culture in the school that is an accepting culture, one that is designed for students and designed so that teachers can build capacity to be able to help students along the way. And that secure environment involves relationships with parents that we talked about a little bit ago, and the community members, and having that collaborative environment where we are not an isolated entity in this community, we are a vibrant member in the community, reaching out to all parts of the community to help us achieve success with our students. We want to demonstrate responsible stewardship of taxpayer investments. You really can't have a document like this if you don't talk about resources. And in this community, we are blessed to have generous people who support our school system. And so we must be mindful of that, we must respect that, and we must take care of their scarce resources. And in this particular case, in the school system, we've heard it in here with Ray, with the Duke Energy types of things, you hear other types of deficiencies with our staff models and so forth and so on. There is an expectation that we rise to that level, and we are efficient in the things that we do. However, the efficiency is not just about money. It's about making sure that we make decisions that are appropriate for students in efficient ways, and we are doing it at a faster pace. Deliver multi-source communications. Multi-source came into this document along the way because people want to get information from the school on a regular basis, and they want that information to come to them on the devices in which they choose to receive that information. So that's where you see multi-source communication. So in this document, we've really transitioned it from what it was 5 months ago into something that I think is more organic, that is more usable, something that will not be put up on the shelf, that will actually provide guidance for us as a school district as we make continued decisions about the future. So the bottom on the PowerPoint behind me, that you can see over there, says next steps. So if the board is inclined to accept this document as presented, maybe has an edit or two that you would like to see, or have questions that maybe can guide us into the future, and certainly we have ideas and recommendations for us as a leadership team. The next plan is to take this document and really begin to set the map for the next 5 years. The year-by-year decisions that we'd like to make, things that we would like to implement to make this plan really become alive. The metrics, the benchmarks, the dollar amounts, the timelines, the people responsible, the evaluation of the plan, and so forth and so on. And so the next step for the administrative team, if in fact the board is approving this tonight, and certainly not by a vote, but approving the concept, then we will begin our work as administrators to truly then put the rest of the meat on this bone, to really add the value to it and the items that you want to see as a board and our community expects for not only their kids, but for us as a school district. So that would be the next steps in this process after this evening. And at this point, I have to say, I can't thank the people here this evening and the committee and all those who participated along the way, because it was an expedited schedule. And I think we have a document that is very much in line with what we should be doing as a school district, and it pushes us as administrators, teachers, and even the Board of Education to stretch and to transition our school district into an even greater school district than it is today. So I want to thank you one more time for coming this evening, for participating in the process, and everyone else who participated along the way. Thank you.
Comments from the board at this point?
First of all, to the three presenters, thank you for your very, you don't have to stand up, thank you for your really professional presentations, really good. I have a question at the very end, Scott, and at the very beginning. The very end, when you say the next steps, I didn't get everything you said, you talked about matrix timelines, dollar amounts, who's responsible, things like that. Will that come back to us in another document, or is that sort of a yearly basis that you get that information or anything?
The goal is to get through this evening, literally, and then start tomorrow morning with our leadership team, our cabinet meeting, and start to plot out the pieces and parts so that we can have that for the Board of Education before January of the new year. However, that cannot be done absent of the Board of Education. And that is a document that will come back and forth. That document has information that's been brought to us through the feedback sessions that the board is aware of. And there are pieces and parts that I'm certain board members want to see in this plan as we move forward over the next 5 years to make this come alive. So that will be back and forth between myself and the Board of Education. Then we will present that formally, and then we will have a year-by-year roadmap, so to speak, that it can be flexible, will be organic in and of itself, to move forward and have legitimate benchmarks along the way each year.
Okay. Question at the beginning. We used to have a vision success for all students. It is now striving to ensure success for all students. Yes? Yes. So how does that job with Engage Empower Excel? I know we just rebranded to Engage Empower Excel. So other than in this plan, where do we talk about the vision? Does that make sense to you? How do the two work together?
How do we find Engage Empower Excel?
Well,
is that?
We used to have only Success for All Students, and then we rebranded to Engage Empower Excel, which we all liked, we all bought into, we all approved. Now there's a vision striving to ensure success for all students. Is that, that's our overall vision, that right. Sort of replaces Success for All Students?
Striving to ensure success for all students.
Yes.
That's our new vision.
Okay.
The Engage Empower Excel, when the document was it found itself where the We Believe Learning is right now. The committee, along with the superintendent, felt that those three words did not describe it well enough. So we placed, we put more of what Engage, Empower, and Excel means in the belief statements, and we have Engage, Empower, and Excel. We believe that this document does better engage students, better empower them because it asks for it throughout the document, and then ultimately they will excel. So they do come together. In this process, the Engage and Empower and Excel, to be quite honest, was out prior to this work being done. But as the work occurred and grew over time, those three words then became a very nice umbrella statement that all of this sort of fits under.
Yeah, a vision and a tagline can coexist. It just depends on what you choose to
agree.
Focus on.
I absolutely agree. I just wanted you to sort of explain it. So we're all on the same page and it's, we can embrace both. I'm good. Thank you.
Jim?
Yeah, You know, I want to join everybody else in thanking the superintendent and this wonderful committee for all the work that they've done. I've always been much better at recognizing the great work of others than I have in doing it myself. And what I really liked about the presentation tonight is the detail, the time, the effort, and maybe more than anything else, the involvement and input from such a diverse group of people, the educators, parents, business people. I know if I'd have sat down to do this myself, I wouldn't have come up with anything nearly as encompassing and broad and complete. And you know, that's kind of the old two heads are better than one in this case. I know you've got a committee of, you know, whatever it was, about 10 of you, and then so many more were involved, and you know, good things come through a good process. So thank you very much. Everything's good.
I've got the same thing. I had the same question that Julie did too. So thank you for going through a couple of different visions in just the past 8 years. And I mean, they're all encompassing, the whole idea is the same, but I like the striving aspect of it. And I also think this is a fan, thank you, of course, as well. I mean, it was a lot of work, and I know many of the people involved, and they really put a lot of time and effort into it, and that was, that's one of the things I think is fantastic about our district and our community, that people from all branches will come together for something like this. So I look forward to the next steps. I think we did an excellent job here, and I think it really lays the groundwork for where we go for the next 5 years.
Tony, anything to add?
No, that's all.
What is it? Scott, I do have one other question. Something that we used to do, I don't know how long we did it, but stopped it at some point, but our agenda used to have, after each point on the agenda, the area of our strategic plan that item related to, and it was helpful. It was, you know, any decision we make ought to somehow be related to our strategic plan, and I liked that we were being reminded as we made decisions, as we sat there and voted on things, how that related to our strategic plan thing. I've always said, if there's not a purpose, don't do it, and that was helpful to me.
We will do that, and great minds think alike, because Mr. Pepper reminded me of that our agendas did have that in the past, and once this thing is completed, then we can start to do that again. I think that's appropriate. We should find this document as our guide. We should be able to refer to it if, in fact, it's the direction we want to go.
I'll just add thank you. I've spent personal time on this committee before, and sometimes it's a challenge, sometimes it's painful, but it's important work. Also appreciate the fact that this was expedited. Typically, a group would probably have a little bit more time than what you had to deliver a high-quality, complete strategic plan. It was very timely. We were due for a refresh, but this is much more than a refresh. So many things are changing. Education delivery is changing. The students that we're getting in are changing, the way they are programmed or wired. State expectations are changing. Right now, we're in the process of, our PIT facilities are all changing. So we're very much at a crossroad where we're reshaping the Forest Hills School District. I'm saying, yeah, it's not here. Okay. Just want to make sure I'm on the right path here. And this is the type of thing that is the fundamental guidepost for how we're going to move forward in the future. And I agree, we need to have this back on the agenda, because everything we do needs to relate back to the strategic plan. Sometimes these are done and they go in a three-ring binder and they're up on a shelf. They gather dust and they pull them off 5 years later and say, check, we have a strategic plan. I think that it's sometimes hard to get your arms around a strategic plan before you see the implementation piece of it. You call it the map. But that is, it's a whole lot easier to sink your teeth into, okay, overall, here's the vision. And oh, by the way, this is what it means. These are the things that we're going to do. And it should be something that will continue out and provide direction and guidance for 5 years. Again, I'm looking forward to the next steps. And I think you said we don't actually have to take formal action tonight, but it sounds like you've got consensus support to move ahead. And we'll look forward to the next steps. Now, unless there's anything else, again, thank you very much. This is important. And I suspect we will see change come out of this. So again, thank you for all your work. Before we move on to the next agenda item, the person had the question, I'm gonna ask that you leave your name and contact information with Mrs. Monk at the table so follow-up can take place at the appropriate time. Anything else on strategic plan? Again, this is more important than it may appear because this is really the foundation for the direction of the school district for years to come. Moving on, 7.2, facilities update, another important piece.
The next part that I'd like to talk about regarding facilities is transportation. So, for those of you who are on the left side of the room, it would be easier for you to see that. For those of you on the right side of the room, this is a picture of the proposal for Anderson High School and transportation in the school district. And it might be a little hard to see right now if we're trying to enlarge it. But what I intend to share with you tonight are some aspects of this proposal, this particular drawing. So we would go to the next slide now. And what we will see is this plan that we're going to talk about this evening has some components that are very important for transportation department as well as for Anderson High School. It's going to have, we're going to talk about centralized staffing of our business operations. We're going to talk about the commitment of the bond levy that was passed so generously by our community, making sure that we fulfill the obligations to the community that they expect of us. We're going to talk about safety and security during the school day, as well as safety and security after hours at the campus. And we're going to talk about some enhancements that we have with this plan in regard to storage for Anderson High School. And then I want to talk a little bit about a projected or a proposed timeline. So if we go to the next slide, that centralized business operation staffing, there's a check mark there that you can see. And what we want to do with this plan is we'd like to move all of our transportation, food service, maintenance, and transportation staff to be located where this large check mark is. So we will consolidate the offices, or those offices, to one place, which will be moving us more towards that efficiency that we talked about a little bit earlier. And we also want to, in the smaller check mark, take the parking for all those individuals who will be using that facility and move them over there. And future plans in this particular proposal would incorporate potentially an innovation type facility at that same place where the large check mark is for different types of engaged learning for students who may be coming from different places within our school district, as well as having innovative professional development opportunities
for our staff in that location. The other thing that would benefit from this is we would have all of our maintenance vehicles and storage equipment all on one site in a secured location. So this area that is represented right here, that is currently now, this is our central office, our district office, and our baseball field is here. This would suggest that there would be some parking that would go in here that would be for the people who are driving the buses that would be parked here. And this particular point of this property would be where the maintenance vehicles and where some of the storage for access would be. But this is now going to be one, if this is approved, one spot for our entire transportation department, as well as all of those other offices that I talked about. So this is centralizing the business office and the business office staffing and operations. The next slide that comes up has a few more very important check marks. And this really goes back to the commitment to our community regarding the bond levy that was passed. When this originally took place, there was a design that was proposed in this that had most of everything out here on Forest Drive, which is right here. It runs from south to north. This would be the new high school area turnaround or drop-off for buses and students in the morning, and the updated new office for the building. Over here is the elimination of the transportation house that we currently have offices in, which would go over there. This particular part is the new science wing. This is the new turnaround area for our high school as proposed. This was proposed originally to be student parking. So you can see from the top arrow all the way down to the bottom arrow over here, the original design of this project was to have very nice new facade, new arrangement. And what we were trying to do at that time is have all of the students and all the access for students enter into this side of the building if they were coming to park cars, and come here if they're coming off the buses. Current situation is kids are parking over here and they're accessing the building from many different places around the back. And so from a security standpoint, this model that we have here, I hate to use the word isolate, but that truly is, we're isolating our students to this particular area where we can have better coordination of their parking in the morning, better coordination of them coming into the lot, and we can have them coming into one specific place in the building where we would have better supervision and not have full access to many doors around the outside. So from a safety and security point, that's important. The budgetary parameters for this the relocation of transportation is also met with this plan and this recommendation. Because with the coordination of the district's district office move, neither additional property is going to be needed, nor are we going to have to buy or build any new facilities. We will upgrade facilities that we currently have. So this is important for us. But from an operational standpoint, having talked to Mike Overby and also talked to Mike Broadwater, who are the former principal and current principal, this setup seems to be the best for them, for Mike Overby now, to maintain the level of expectation we have for safety and security with students in that particular time. So this is sort of fulfilling the original design that was presented to the community as I understand it. The next slide talks about school hour safety and security. So when you have, this offers centralized parking for students, as we talked about a few minutes ago, egress during and after school access to the building, centralized dismissal times, eliminating multiple access points. The other thing to think about with this is the traffic patterns in the building for this slide. When students are coming to school, they will enter and they will turn right and they will park. When parents are coming to school to drop off kids, the students, drivers will go right and they will go through the circle. So ultimately our traffic begins to peel itself apart. And then an even better part of this plan is that over here, without going through parents or students, we have the bus turnaround. So what this plan effectively does is it separates student driving from parent drop-off and bus drop-off. It does that in the morning time, and in the afternoon, it allows students to have a long queue line all the way down to Beachmont Avenue, which is important for us at the end of the day. It also provides our buses who are coming in and out to also have a long queue line at the end of the day. And that was a big component of this plan, when I was talking a few weeks ago about potentially having student parking here, it reduced that queue line, offering much more congestion in that part of the high school plant. So this plan sort of helps us with eliminating some of that confusion. There's also adequate isolated staff parking with this particular plan. When all of this particular area right here is available for staff parking, this particular area back here where the large check mark is also for staff parking. So those two things are important for us, and right now we have staff intermingled with students, and that's just a difficult thing for us in the morning. It has worked over time, but we believe that this model that has availability for staff in both of these places is a better model. It also takes the small little check mark over here. If you remember, board members, right here, somewhere in this area, is the fuel station for the school district. It's not problematic, but it could be problematic before school, during school, and after school, because it's a fuel tank in the middle of parking. So when we take it and we put it into a different place over here, sort of off of Anderson High School's campus, so to speak, it no longer is a part of the day safety issues or anything like that before, during, and after school. And we believe that it's much more safe and secure because it's behind that fence area. So we have that. And that is an after-hour advantage as well. Then we have the after-hour component of this plan that we'd like to propose to you. Evening guests and visitors have adequate event parking and are guided to centralized entrances and locations. This is important for us. This plan offers, if you are coming to Titus for an auditorium performance, you have parking here. You also have adequate handicap parking for the elderly and for people who truly have a handicap or some specialized need. So you have adequate parking for Titus. We also have adequate parking here for other school events like basketball and things that are happening with parents and guests. We also have adequate parking here at the end of the day for people to come to a football game and traverse down through this pathway. So this plan offers us after-hours opportunity for plenty of parking here, plenty of parking here, not only for football, but for other events like tennis, softball, baseball, and some track that we'll be having up here in the plan. You can't quite see that. The other thing this affords us is additional parking in the front of the building that we don't currently have. For visitors who come to the building at the end of the day, who don't need to come in back here, but need to go directly to the office to drop off their child, pick up their child, or anything else. So we have those access points here where sort of our parking lots are directing people. The one thing we want to be careful of is having a lot of parking available here for people who want to go to Titus or who want to go to a basketball game to have to try to seek and find their way, as opposed to coming into a corridor where they have immediate access or access that's better available for them to get where they need to go. The other thing that this provides us, or the other opportunity that this provides us, if you look over here, there will be one sport that we can think of where there will be bus traffic coming in the evening time sporadically after they finish their runs that will pass by the baseball field. And one of the goals of this plan was to the best of our ability, move Anderson High School as far away from transportation as we could and still utilize this property efficiently. So this is the one lane that we can think of for about 6 weeks a year, about 14 or 15 home baseball games, varsity a minute, those rest of the week, where we would have sporadic traffic, bus traffic in the evening time. But all of the rest of the campus now, all of the rest of the campus, we've been able to separate. And I think that was my thought. That was a good idea when the plan was originally designed, to try to separate that to the best of our ability we could. So the after-hour safety and accessibility to the building is better and more controlled with this particular plan. The other thing this plan offers is much more storage at Anderson High School. So the next slide that we're going to see shows you that we are going to have storage available here for gator-type things, lawnmowers, things that are heavy equipment-type things that are used in outdoor this area right here, which is currently where our bus garage or where our buses get worked on right now, that has a heater in it, so this is going to be good for Titus storage as well as other storage for outdoor. We also have, with the new facility, we'll have storage on the first floor there, and we also have some storage up there right now where you would be at the shot put area. So we have four storage facilities that will add a lot of opportunity for storage that we don't currently have. Yes?
I'm sorry, you're on a roll. Are we repurposing the bus garage for storage? Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, this and these two areas. And those are minimal cost because both of those facilities are in pretty good shape. What we're talking about is a new facade on the front, updating them to a level that is that supports what we're trying to do with the rest of the facilities coming around there. So what you will see then when you come into the new facility, when you drive down Forest, you'll see a brand new front entrance. You'll see a new green space. You'll see a brand new science wing. You will see a new parking lot. You will see a new turnaround. You will see better looking storage and more storage. And you will also see the back of the football stadium with a little bit of cement work done in the grout work. So what you will see, in addition to that, as you traverse back even further, you will see all new right in through here with our new facility for the weight room. So it's going to be a very nice streetscape, if you will, for visitors to our facility, and we will have better access to all the places that people need to go in a more secure environment, we believe. So the storage is also something that's very important to our athletic department as well as our performing arts department, and that's a nice multi-use for them. The last thing that I want to talk to you about is enhanced outdoor facilities, and this is a sort of down the road third stage in the project. Anderson High School, transportation, and then as we continue down the road, we wanted to talk about those outdoor multi-use surfaces that we have available. So in the third stage of the project, where you see this check mark, there is potential opportunity for a turf field there, as well as an upgraded softball field and an upgraded shot put area for students who are participating in track. Think about it, you know what I mean? So that's what this check mark is about. And again, all of those will have adequate parking available for them because we will have that in this particular plan. There's another part. This up here, as far as outdoor, this parking and this parking will be available for individuals who come to watch baseball games. And we've had limited parking there, and that's been some of the confusion in the evening time. So that will provide us some additional spots up front where people have a very short walk to the baseball field. There also is a parking lot here that has access to this restroom, so people will feel more comfortable about walking on a parking lot to get to the restroom as opposed to a field, especially if it's in inclement weather. So the last slide I'd like to show you to sort of wrap this up is the staging process that I think is important for us. And sequence of the project here in green is important. And so the number here is represented over here. So if you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 as these numbers appear here are staged, and there are also some projected dates available for us to take a look at. And the first thing, the most important thing on our plates right now is Anderson High School. We want the bid process to get completed. We're working very hard on that with our architects. We're looking at a September 1. Now, we were talking about August, but I think in the best interest of everybody involved, having a September time period is going to work out for us, and we're doing that with some coordination with our county offices and permits and other things we're trying to accomplish internally with our mechanisms internally to make sure that we are able to move forward with our projects in a timely and efficient manner. So the first step, September of 2016, is when we'd like to be moving forward with the Anderson bid process and really knowing what we're going to be doing on that campus. The second part is October 16th, and that is moving the central office administration to the new facility that the board purchased so that that facility then can be eliminated for use for the administration and start to move the other individuals who will be working in those offices over to that building. And so in October, you will see the central office move take place, and that's October 2016. You see here, after the winter is over, we get into March. This is a sequenced event. We want to start moving with the bus garage construction. If, in fact, this is a proposal that the board approves, we want to start moving the earth over here and starting to get this pad down for the busing, and also start to put this transportation parking lot, Innovation Center parking lot in, so that that whole facility over there is ready for buses and is ready for parking for individuals who drive buses. That will happen in March. Now, that doesn't mean that the transportation department is moving over there in March. That means that's when we're going to start working on that particular part of the process. The fourth stage then is transportation and the student parking switch. And the fourth stage is over here in August of 2017. So next summer, number four begins to happen, so that we can have all of this area, all of this turnaround, the in and out corridor or lane, if you will, all prepared for an August 2017 switch from transportation and students parking. So that would take place. And then the fifth part of the plan is the multi-purpose field, which is over here. And the building is up to be running in 17-18, so we believe that this is an August of 18, if it occurs, the way the board would like for it to happen, that this five-stage process ends in August of 2018. So hopefully I've been able to provide the best information possible regarding the rationale for the decision to bring this to you as a proposal, and also give you an idea of how this would be staged and the sequence that it would happen, and remind the board that we believe that all of this can happen within the budgetary allowances that are provided by the Board of Education, with some additional dollars that we have always talked about, at least during my time, with some interest dollars that we have, with some Duke Energy rebates that we have, and with some permanent improvement dollars that we currently are not using on our facilities because we have the generosity of our community with the $103 million of bond money. So those are still to be determined decisions, and those are the last decisions, the third decision, because we want to make sure Anderson High School is taken care of first, transportation has what it needs second, and then we move to that third leg of the project, hopefully by 2018 in August, we'll put the whole thing together. And that third leg does include Turpin High School. So there's an equal discussion taking place with those additional funds at Turpin so that we have those fields over there as well. That's all I've got.
Thank you for your detailed presentation. This it's a complex plan, and I know it's like the plane has been circling on this thing for quite some time, and it's good to bring it in for a landing finally. Appreciate the fact that we're dealing with it today, because my understanding is the stake was put in the ground so that we needed to act today in order to prevent anything negative from happening by delaying anything else going forward with Anderson. Let me just stop and ask, does anybody have any questions? I think we've seen probably a dozen different iterations of this plan, but I think this one's probably, with all the eyeballs that have looked at this, the optimum plan given the resources that we have.
So I've got zero spatial awareness, and I can't read a map to save my life, let alone a little child over there. We have, on the current Anderson campus, some parking difficulties and traffic issues. We're taking the existing campus, we're doing some additional construction on the campus, taking up some additional space. We're moving transportation over to where the administration building is, eliminating the two buildings in front. Are we netting more parking here somehow?
Yes. We're actually picking up more parking spaces. Because we're going to reduce
I can't picture.
Okay. When we take out the current transportation office, we pick up spaces there. When we change the transportation from actually parking in the student area now to their own site, so to speak, where they're getting out of their cars at their site and going in, we also pick up those 70 spots during the day. So we have much more access during the day for our students than we currently have. And we actually count the spaces. There are legitimately more spaces, many more spaces available. The plan that I didn't talk about, and I'm glad you asked that question, in this area right here, Mr. Krugman, it says that there's opportunity, just above the number two, right up there, there's opportunity to even expand parking if we find out that we don't have enough. So we have a legitimate place to even develop more if we need to. But the plan right now, working with our athletic directors, is to minimize elimination of green space anywhere. So this plan has an opportunity to actually grow if necessary. So we're picking up spaces, we're putting them closer to the areas that people need access, and we're giving our transportation department 96 spaces that do not currently exist on our property when you combine both pieces of the property together.
And the bus traffic will be going where?
The bus traffic stays in the front of the building. Okay, at 6 a.m., really early in the morning, most of us are sleeping, transportation folks come in, they start doing their thing, and they're going to be leaving this exit before anybody really starts to come in to school. They're going to be taking off. So when they come back in, they're going to come down Forest Road, or they're going to come in the other way, and they're going to go here. So our buses are going to be in the front of our building, unloading students to go into this particular area. Our parents then will pass by our buses because we put a wider lane in here, which gives better access down that road to begin with. So as buses are going in, that doesn't mean that cars are going to have to stop. We're still going to be able to utilize that road with two-way traffic. So buses will be here, which allows parents to be able to come in this lane and go left and out without crisscrossing through students, other than to come in with them. Students will go one way, parents will go the other. Students will park, parents will then be their own traffic going out left or right, whichever way works for them. So we've separated busing from students and parents to a high degree. And we've also separated parent traffic from student parent in the morning time. Which means if you're a parent and you're coming to this campus over the next 2 years when this is done, I think your experience is going to be better than what it is right now. And I think you're going to feel more comfortable and more safe about your pattern of transportation than maybe you do now with some of the level or volume of traffic that we have in congested areas.
First, thank you everyone, because we've looked at this every which way. We've looked at a lot of different sites that couldn't work, decided to keep it on the Anderson campus, and it's been back and forth, and this is clearly the best solution for your what we have. Just have two questions. One is, there's a sort of a big queue in the morning for parents dropping their kids off. And you used to be able to come in and there was a lot of space between where you drove in and where you pulled around and where you dropped your kid off at the current entrance. That is going to be a shorter distance from the road to where you drop your kid off now. And I understand there's a bigger lane to access, maybe egress too. But how is that queue going to not back up for the parent drop-off? In a very short time, in the morning and in the afternoon, when parents drop off their kids, it just seems like it's going to spill out into Forest Road to me for a long way. I don't understand how that's going to work.
I think you're ready to help me with this now, because I believe this area is elongated.
Yeah.
And it's elongated because when the science wing gets added on, you then need that extra distance. So you pick it up going in and you pick it up going out. And you also have the full length of the front of the building as well as down the south side of the forest. So that queue should be elongated a little bit. And when you eliminate the students and the parents together to a certain extent, then the flow seems to go, the pattern, because people are all going in the same direction. So I can't tell you exactly what that's going to do for the length of the queue, but I think the time for a parent to come in, drop off their student, and go out of the parking lot, I believe, will be reduced by this plan from what I've seen in the short time I've been in position.
And you'll have staff out there kind of making it flow.
And there's a turn lane included in this on the forest, so heading southbound on the forest, there's a left-hand turn lane on the campus, so the people who will be heading south beyond the Anderson, the traffic will continue to flow down that way, so that would help as well.
Is there a plan to have a policeman there? Or is there a plan to have a policeman there? This looks to me very similar to what Turbine has now,
They have at least now there now.
That's what I'm saying. What is the plan is to keep some, just because to your point, because I was thinking the same thing, is right now you have some of the students parking where number four is, correct? And then most of them parking in.
All the students will be here now.
No, I know, but currently some are there and some are behind the building, right?
Yes. So most are behind the building.
So that was just where, you know, so you have two different places and those two entries, which would decompress that area as opposed to now everyone's at the same time is going to be going into the same entrance.
Well, what you have now is where area four is, you have parents, students, bus drivers, and employees.
Although the bus drivers aren't even there. They're long
right. Well, they're coming and going, some. So you're separating that, and the whole idea is the separation of the bus traffic from the parents and students. You know, the buses are going out at the time the staff are coming in. So that's kind of clean for that.
Currently, the police officers are directing traffic. It's for the students in the back there. Now you'll be able to move that police officer down, who will be controlling the students as well as the parents as well.
My other question is, you mentioned the Innovation Center, we've been talking about that for a while too, but it's not, let me back up. The current administration building will house, renovated, I guess, it will house transportation, food services, and maintenance. Is that same building going to have the Innovation Center in it, or do you foresee that being a separate building? I didn't quite understand.
I foresee that as a building with two separate things happening inside.
Okay. But for right now, whatever changes we're making, will that include the Innovation Center renovation as well?
At this point in time, it changes a few things. The front entrance will change for some offices, and it will be changed if you put when we put the transportation on the side, there will be access to the building from that side. The new Innovation Center, there's a sidewalk that's built in there that I looked at on the plans. There'll be a new entrance, a more inviting entrance, and you won't have to go around the back of the building anymore to come to that facility.
Can we fit all that in that little building? I'm looking at you, I don't know why.
I believe so, because we have the offices will be separate from the Innovation Center. And there's actually a lot of room back where it is.
Oh, I forgot
about
this
old. And we're also taking all the staff, most of the staff, not all, except into the new central office building. So there'll be a way to move some space around. But, you know, we talked a little bit earlier about the strategic plan. In the strategic plan, I'm certain one of the line items in there is going to be Innovation Center. And today, we don't have the actual definite design of that building because we haven't necessarily talked about the curricular aspects and the needs of our students and all the things that have to happen.
It's still conceptual to some extent. Right.
But we do think that there's, at least at this particular point, two very nice sized classrooms that can still be in that building with other things that can go on. And those classrooms, if they're used for students in the daytime, can also be used for professional development in the nighttime and in other parts of the day when students aren't accessing that. So an Innovation Center is about students and staff together in that space.
And that will be accessible as it's intended now to the whole district.
Yes, and the other part about that, again, is when you get here, if and when this becomes a more vibrant Innovation Center, that goes back to Mr. Freeman's question about parking, then we can expand that parking so that the access for students and people utilize that building as the building grows in its use, so too parking. And that's important. We don't want to build it before we know exactly what we're going to do, we have a sense of what it's going to be. So the plan includes opportunity to expand parking as needed.
It also shows the added value. I mean, if you look, you know, the fact that we're not moving transportation off-site allows us to do the multi-purpose fields. That allowed, you know, the fact that the bumping administration allowed us to do an Innovation Center, which was never part of the plan. So those are all, you know, added values that come back based on things that have happened since the bond issue.
Now I want to go back and check my notes just to make sure that we're adding about 120 student parking spaces on campus.
Well, Well, we all know the Herculean efforts that have gone into trying to find alternatives. And I don't see a better plan than what's been presented today. And I'm short of us finding that other location, the price point, satisfying. This looks good to me. Richard, what do you think?
It's all good.
Well, there you go.
I can speak to some of the traffic issues. As far as the queue line, so to speak, for parent traffic in the morning, this will be much, much safer than what we currently have. You currently have students walking through a line of buses. You have drivers walking through a line of parent traffic and student traffic. Just separating those pieces is phenomenal.
Thank you. That helps a
lot.
We
also have our students with disabilities buses that drop off in an area that doesn't necessarily have great access for that particular student body. Will now be in the front of the building with much more handicap accessible doors, pavement, so forth and so on, where those students will have a better experience coming in and out. And those children are accessing the building during times when people are driving back and forth, and that is a significant safety issue for that population of our school. So this plan offers a much higher degree of safety for those students.
Was there, at some point in all of this, we talked about a partnership with the township as far as the Innovation Center. Is there still interest along those lines? I know there was quite a bit months ago, but has that entered into the equation? I know that's somewhat of a side issue compared to the overall transportation. Do we have any communication on those lines?
I think some of that was when we talked about trying to put our facilities, transportation facilities together.
I think there are two different areas. That was one, and of course, since we're not really doing that, there still might be some opportunities. I think it was on fuel and a couple of other things. But then 90 degrees from that, we were talking about with the Township Development Committee, there may be some opportunities there, but that's not associated with this, and it's way down the road. Tony, anything? Good. Thank you, I appreciate you.
Can I do one more thing?
Sure.
I want to put him on the spot. Mike?
I think this is the year that I've been involved with this, probably the best plan, based on the design of the building south and west. And the other plan was north and east with parking. One of the things that I've noticed over my year is that it's hard to lock down this building at night if people have to get in through entrances and things like that are in the back of the building. That wasn't going to get any better with the previous iteration of the plan. So I'm very excited to have, if you think about our large group events, thousands of people at Brown Stadium, 600 people at Titus, 1,000 people at a basketball game. Now they all can come through the same entrances and we can keep our building secure. So the evening piece is there. One thing that around the parking, if we have 100 more student spots, that reduces probably 40 parents dropping off and maybe a bus. If parents have access, if students know throughout their sophomore year when students are gaining access. Right now, we'll sell out this year. There's no doubt we're going to sell out, but if we have 100 more spots, that's now reducing parents dropping off. So that's something that, when you were talking about the queue and things, I think that'll reduce that as well.
Again, thank you. Appreciate the detail because this was a complex plan. We've looked at this for quite some time. Three superintendents have worked on this, and I'm confident that at this point we've got the optimum plan given the resources we've got, and knowing that we kind of punted on any facility outside of the campus that we have now, it just wasn't there.
Well, I think that was the key with all of this is three superintendents, multiple committees. We've had involvement of all the major stakeholders, from buses to parents to students, and that's what the take home I get, I know this is the culmination of, you know, a gigantic effort for this. And, you know, you go through and we all have our own ideas of where and every single place in all of Anderson and Newtown and even points beyond, you know, Omaha County, they've all been vetted and gone through all of it. And this is where we are. So you've done a great job.
We have consensus support. I don't think we have to actually take any action at this point, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
And much of it will come through Mr. Johnson and the processes that have to take place in the bids and all those types of things.
So. Okay. Very good. These were two lengthy topics, but both extremely important, and I appreciate the detail on both. I know the rest of the board does also. Moving on to items 8.1, appointment of board committees. At the beginning of the year, we set up, did I skip something?
Ray has quite a few things to.
Oh, the facilities update. Okay. I was looking dark on the agenda. Sorry, Ray. I saw the change orders, I thought those were later in the agenda.
Well, they are.
Just to really kind of give you a quick update, I'm going to ask Dave to come on up here so we can kind of make this a little bit shorter, just concerned for time. As you might imagine, it's rather hectic in our world right now. You know, I'm asking all the principals, I'm looking right in the eyes and saying, please, for patience. But I think they're kind of seeing the end. I think that Dan and Todd would tell you, how hectic it is, and the hustle and bustle is, you know, well worth it at this point. It's coming. But we've had a hectic couple of weeks here. You know, one of the things is we had a, you know, getting back kind of what seemed to be our old nemesis, the Hamilton County Building Department. Randy and Scott and I met with the county administrator, as well as the administrator for the building department and their lead plans examiner last Friday morning to kind of review where we were at with things. And it wasn't really to go down to chastise people, but really try to figure out how we can make the process better. And I think we had a fairly productive meeting with them. The one thing that kind of caught us off guard that we had not heard from anybody prior to last Friday morning at 9 o'clock was them saying that they were a little concerned that we were going to be able to open up a couple of buildings today. So, which prompted a 2-hour conference call with them before we went home on Friday, which then prompted a meeting with them today where we actually brought them out to our buildings. I think the meeting went good. I mean, I think that obviously, I think Dave will tell you that Aaron Sherman was very, very comfortable to have their temporary certificates spot. You can see staff from those buildings this evening, and even beginning to get their rooms set up. So those really aren't any issues. We made a lot of progress at Summit in Mercer the last couple of days. Mark Quality Company's a contractor of both buildings. They had crews working two shifts, Saturday and Sunday. We made a lot of progress. The classrooms are really in very good shape over Mercer. One of the issues we have there, we have a lot of inspections have to take place. And we all kind of thought that one of the critical inspections had taken place. So we kind of got that resolved today. We had an inspection this afternoon. We have to get electrical inspections out of the way first, and then the buildings inspector will come in and do an inspection and give us a certificate of occupancy. His part of it, he says, I think Dave would tell you, is pretty much a slam dunk from that aspect. But these electrical inspections have to take place and get scheduled before them. So I'm not going to say that it's 100% certain that we're not going to have maybe some issue next Monday, but we'll have a clear understanding by the end of the day tomorrow on that. I think we feel much better as far as Summit goes. The classroom finishes aren't quite what they are over at Mercer, but I think we all felt very very comfortable having a walk through with Bruce Grace and our inspector today as far as gaining the temporary certificates of occupancy. The only stipulation they've had is before we get those, they will allow staff to come in and work on setting up their classrooms. We have no contractors on site like we're doing this, first of all. But they said until we get that, they do not want anybody else in the building with them, particularly kids. It's just, you know, things are getting cleaned up and so forth, and they just don't want to take a chance of kids running around in the building. And first and foremost is the safety of everybody. And it's really kind of the key of today's two-hour tour of the offices for the schools. The other thing, just to give you a brief update, is Greater Cincinnati Water Works. We met with them, I think I've mentioned before, on June 30th. Kind of put to bed the whole thing with Anderson. We understand that we're going to have to probably extend the water line down Forest Road. However, I ran into a gentleman who's an engineer Saturday evening who's going to work in the Metropolitan Sewer District, and he said, be sure to ask them why you have to do that. His wife's an attorney. She said, yes, be sure to ask Ms. Baker why you have to do that, or Ms. Baker, excuse me, why you have to do that, because it's been challenged in places. So I intend to do that because I do have a meeting with her. But the interesting thing is the compromise that we proposed as we left that meeting was very quickly set aside and denied a couple of weeks ago. Miraculously, over the weekend, the same entity now proposed, now it's their idea, our exact compromise, and they're willing to let us do it, which is much less expensive. So that's what we're pursuing right now. We're trying to put that into writing that we're going to accept the compromise, but I'm still going to go down and meet with the director because I really think she needs to know kind of how this process is all played out for us. So there's a lot going on. You know, we've got other stuff going on. We're wrapping up over at Nagel. We've got a little bit of foreign work we have to do over there. We've started doing some dental work at Turpin. We actually probably will be literally breaking ground sometime early part of next week for the addition over there. So just stay tuned.
Well said. So I'm going to do a video and an audio presentation at the same time to kind of conserve time because you guys have already had a lot more to come. So these are just some pictures that are going to be running in no particular order. It's certainly not in the order of what I'm going to say. But some befores, some afters, some currents, and just and some of them are pretty amazing because like a month ago, it looked like the war's out, and today, Aaron Sherwood would look pretty good. One thing that Ray said, that I am confident that on the 22nd, your kids will, or 29th, the kids will be in the building. I am confident that we've got 6 days and 12 hours to be able to accomplish that. And I actually have been here before with buildings. We're about the condition I thought we would be in at both Mercer and Summit. Big chunks of work to accomplish in a small chunk of time. The contractors have been great to work with. They have resource loaded, that means bodies available as much as possible. Our region is slammed, busy, great for our region, bad for us trying to get lots of work done in a small period of time. As Ray said, Turpin barriers are going up. We'll break ground next week as soon as the permit is placed. The early site work package has progressed. We're over there right now, finishing up quickly so that on the 26th, when all you fine folks are having breakfast over there, you've got all the parking you need. A great deal of thanks is due to Duke. Duke accelerated a 12-week engineering program into about 12 hours, and we are getting a gas line relocated as a result. Anderson, the site work is complete there, and all the abatement work is done. Matter of fact, in all the buildings, all the abatement work is done, which is a benefit because then it allows the contractor to move right in and start their work. Anderson's out for bid on the streets, and current schedule is that would open September 14th. As Ray said, Nagel, the site work is complete. I think you saw a picture of the aerial of that. And we're finishing up the door program this week. I think we'll be 100% with the door program, both stage doors and sliding classroom doors. Aaron Sherwood, ready to occupy. I think we just need a piece of paper that says that, but they look like a school in the last stages of getting ready for students. So both of those buildings have one area, which was always the plan. In fact, our contractor, both of those contractors, made up all the time lost waiting for permits. They are really on schedule. We have three classrooms at each of those buildings that never intended to be ready by September or August of this year, due to be ready by end of September, beginning of October. So we're right on schedule there. Maddox, the site work is done. The paving work is complete. And the documents are being prepared for a bid opening in near October. Again, the paving work is complete there. Wilson, and that's the picture you're seeing of Wilson right now. And that's the old pictures, because there's actually walls that are protruding out of the ground right now. Contractors making good progress there, and the slabs are being poured, and we're on schedule there. I'm here to say. Summit and Mercer, I kind of saved those for last because they're the ones with lots of work yet to be done. But as Mr. Johnson said, the rooms are being set up. All the classrooms are available at both buildings for teachers to begin building their room, if you will. At Summit, that began today at 3 o'clock. I understand tomorrow they're not back until 3 o'clock, but they're going to come back and start again to set their classrooms up. And then at Mercer, we've got Wednesday morning, they'll be on site to start setting up their classrooms. When I say set up, the custodians have already cleaned the room, put their furniture in those rooms so they can begin the setup process. And by Wednesday morning, both of those buildings will have very few contractors in the building at all. There'll be no construction materials in the building. And school can kind of start to begin to get cleaned up and ready to go. And certainly I apologize to everybody at those buildings that they're as dirty as they are. But it was a lot of work in a small period of time. So your flexibility has really what has been able to give us the ability to do those projects. Any questions? Well, thank you. We'll be back next month with pictures of where we were last August and this August. I think it'll be kind of fun to see this. Thanks.
Thank you. Anything else on facilities? Open up. Item 8.1, board committees, very briefly. Beginning of the year, we had an elaborate committee set up after some practical experience and some experience from our superintendent with committees. We've streamlined that a little bit. This requires action simply because, the president can appoint committees, but we approved them as a board in January, so is there a motion to approve these revised committees?
I move to approve the revised plan.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Teffer?
Mrs. Bissinger?
Yes.
Mr. Krumen?
Yes.
Dr. Heiss?
Yes.
Mr. Hemelgorn?
Yes.
Mr. Smith?
Yes. Appreciate everybody's cooperation and work on the committees. This is streamlined. In place of some of the committees, we've got some lead people. Some of the topics just didn't really require a formal committee because that doesn't require minutes. For example, I think I'm the lead person on technology, and some others may be lead people on certain other areas. The expectation is staff would go to that person if they want any kind of board input. Moving on to board discussion. The only thing I have is at your places, I've provided a copy of the board priorities and goals for 2016. With my assessment of what we are midway through the year, and we don't need to discuss this evening, I just wanted to point that out, and if anybody has any thoughts, I just want to use it as a reminder for the things that we set up as our priorities for the beginning of the year. If anybody does have input on that, let me know. We'll review this again in December. Anything else for more discussion? Hearing none, we will move on to item number 9, business operations. Who's up? Mr. Johnson. Elimination of reduced price charges in the school meal program. Oh, thank you. Yeah, are we at consent agenda here for all these various? Okay, yeah, starting at 9.1.
What we want to do at the beginning of this school year is we bring, I brought to you in the past, the pricing for school lunches is that for the students who qualify, or the families who qualify for free and reduced or for reduced lunches, the students are required to pay 40 cents per student for lunch or 30 cents per student for breakfast. And what we're proposing is to eliminate and waive that fee for the 16-17 school year. We feel that with the balance that we have there and the fact that we believe that we still, even with those reduced prices, have many students or many families that have multiple students in the school system that aren't getting proper nutrition during the first course of the school day. So the superintendent recommends the board approve the elimination of the reduced price charge at the school meal program for the 16-17 school year. Any questions?
There was it legislation or some regulation that changed that allowed us to do that, because in the past we couldn't do it, correct?
No, it's, we could do, I think there's been a recent legislation to give schools the option in the last couple of years of doing this, and we talked to some other districts, and I think there's a number of them that at this time of year have made the decision to do this in the best interest of the kids and their schools.
Okay.
Next item is our transportation agreement of the Marymount City School District. We brought this the last couple of years. What we've done is we've worked out a partnership with them in trying to expedite the transportation of our students to the Scarlet Oaks, getting them a little bit more there on a timely basis. We typically, if we set up a purchase order for a dollar, there's no cost to us for this. It's just more of a convenience, not only for us, but like I said, our kids spend less time on the bus getting there and getting back. So the superintendent recommends the board approve the agreement with Marymount City School District to provide shuttle service for the Forest Hill School District students attending Scarlet Oaks Joint Vocational Center in Sharonville for the 16-17 school year. And I might add, Bronson McCord prepared this agreement for us and East Council for both districts.
They're providing transportation, but I didn't see anything that we're, other than the dollar, that we're providing in exchange for.
We've negotiated their gas and electrical contracts for 7 or 8 years, and we entered into a HVAC maintenance RFP and shopping for them.
Thank you.
Yeah. 9.3 is, I think, Dr. Heisman, your father's favorite items, is the school bus stops for the 16-17 school year. We're required that the have these approved by the Board of Education, and with the timing of things this year, we're actually able to do it before the start of the school year. So the superintendent recommends the board approve bus stops for the 16-17 school year, as well as the authority to designate or relocate subsequent school bus stops be delegated by the board to the superintendent for his designation.
So we probably copies of any of this one.
We've actually moved away from paper copies, but I can get you one on used paper if you want. 9.4 is a change order for Air Elementary School. The motion is to approve the change order submitted by Endeavor Construction, amount of $6,090. To give you just a rough idea, there was a portion of this that was needed to relocate some data telecommunications. We had a small credit back because we were not putting some replacing some carpet in the vestibule. We also found that we had to relocate some conduit in the corridors and to make sure that we had proper filters for the new VAV boxes. Superintendent would recommend the board approve the change order submitted by Endeavor in the amount of $6,093. 9.5 is a change order for the new district office. The motion is to approve the change order submitted by Kramer and Feldman in the amount of $15,160. This is a result of the fact that we found that once we got into the work, we had to relocate some refrigerant piping. We also had to waterproof the elevator pit, adding a sump pump and drain tile. And we had a failed cooling coil in one of the pieces of the mechanical equipment that was being left that we were going to reuse. So the superintendent recommends the board approve the change order submitted by Kramer and Feldman in the amount of $15,160. 9.6 from Mercer Elementary. So approved the change order submitted by Mark Spaulding Company in the amount of $17,010. This change order specifically was we had mechanical work that was related to the support, roof support for the equipment over the top of the gym. We had to add some structural steel there to support that. The superintendent recommends the board approve the change order submitted by Mark Spaulding Company in the amount of $17,010. We have another one for Mercer Elementary and Mark Spaulding. This one, the motion is to approve this change order in the amount of $19,468. This change order was as a result of the fact we were putting in an elevator, we're going to put a new elevator in the rear portion of Mercer this year. We found that we broke out of the wall and began to dig the pit there. All the electrical service for the rear portion of the building passed through that elevator pit. We could not put in the elevator to go down to the level of the arbor because right now it's not accessible by the existing elevator. So the decision was made to put in an ADA compliant ramp that would allow students who are in a wheelchair to access the space more conveniently than a traditional
left that you might see in other places. So the superintendent recommends the board approve the change order submitted by Mark Spalding Company in the amount of $19,468. 9.8 Sherwood Elementary School. This motion is to approve a change order submitted by Cedar Building Company. It's a credit of $7,337. This was a result of when we made the decision that we were going to pull some of the light fixtures they were supplying back into our program. There's a credit of roughly almost $9,900 for that. We also wanted to make sure that we ran proper electric out to the flagpole to have proper illumination of the flag. After hours. So the superintendent recommends that we approve the change order submitted by Cedar Building Company in the amount of a negative $7,337. Summit Elementary School. This change order, there's a motion to approve the change order submitted by Graybar Electric in the amount of $17,967.66. As we've had with several of the other buildings, the change order was the result of a change in light fixtures which provided to Graybar. Initial order was based upon an estimate and the revision is based on the actual construction documents. The superintendent recommends the board approve the change order submitted by Graybar Electric Company in the amount of $17,967.66. Next is Nagel Middle School. Motion here is to approve a change order submitted by Schumacher Dugan Construction Company in the amount of $80,897. This change order is a result of the scope of work being provided by Schumacher Dugan Construction. Specifically, this is for stabilization and drainage that was needed in the upper parking lot behind the building. As we got into this project, we found that there was very little substructure in that parking. The testing of this was something that Bob Vander Wood and I witnessed firsthand. We had to remove a lot of the base material that was back there and replace it in order to get the parking lot in. So the superintendent recommends the board approve the change order submitted by Schumacher Dugan Construction in the amount of $80,897. 9.11, 9.11 is Short Elementary School. This is again a motion to approve the change order submitted by Graybar in the amount of $620.10. We had a few extra light fixtures we had to add to the program here. I think they were predominantly exit light fixtures. The superintendent recommends the board approve the change order submitted by Graybar Electric in the amount of $620.10. Next is 9.12 is Harrah Elementary. Again, this is to Graybar. The motion is to approve the change order submitted by Graybar in the amount of $2,938.41 for a revision in the number of light fixtures. Superintendent recommends the board approve the change order submitted by Graybar in this amount of $2,938.41. 9.13 is a change order for SSOE. It's a motion to approve a change order submitted by SSOE Group. It's a credit of $11,401.16. What this is that during the course of design at Garrett Sherwood, we had some misdesign of cubbies and storage units at those buildings that had to be replaced. It was clearly not reflected properly in the documents supplied by SSOE. After some brief discussion, they agreed to pay for the cost of the new cubbies. We submitted it earlier on the change order because we had to, because the contract was between the school district and the contractors. We did the change order. We're now reducing our financial obligation to SSOE by these like amounts, so we're reducing the purchase. So the superintendent recommends the board approve the change order submitted by SSOE in a negative amount of $11,401.16. Last but not least is finally a change order for the Nagel Middle School. Once again, this is a motion for the change order submitted by Schumacher Dugan in the amount of $37,070. Again, this change order is a result of the change in scope of work being provided by Schumacher Dugan. Specifically, there were soil conditions and additional drainage that once we opened up the front parking lot, had to be replaced. It was our belief that without this, that we would have been in jeopardy of being able to get that parking lot done in time for
for the start of the school year. So the superintendent recommends the board approve the change order submitted by Schumacher Huber Construction in the amount of $37,070. I might add on all these, I mean, we're talking about the change orders. Bob and or I are out on site looking at these things. We're seeing all this stuff firsthand, not just taking, you know, that's in somebody's word for things. And so we're looking at this from the moment these things are brought to our attention. So both these cases, for example, today, not only were there with the contractor, we're there on the weekend with the contractor, we're there with all Witzig, who's doing our special inspections, witnessing these things taking place. And he may have already left, but more often than not, Dave's there with us as we're going through all this.
This is part of the consent agenda. Any questions?
Yeah, great. For all these change orders, I understand the construction change orders can happen for a variety of reasons. Unanticipated conditions, mistakes in drawings, a number of things. But my question is, each building had a contingency fund associated with the amount of money that was going to it, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Are we eating up our contingency funds?
At some of the buildings, yes. And we have actually consciously, when we went out and we did the bid for Wilson and for Turpin, we significantly increased those contingency amounts. We plan on doing the same thing with Anderson and Maddox.
Okay, so just so, I mean, money's going to run out at some point. So if it's on change orders, the additional things that might possibly happen in the ideal world might not.
Pardon, I'm sorry.
The additional things that, we went to each of the schools and talked about what you want and then wish list, and this was prior administration. There were some, not representations, but some soft representations of when we're done with sort of the core plan, we can go back and look at other issues or other items to see if we can put them in. Because we're eating into the contingencies in some buildings, that will reduce the ability to do that.
Right, and it's going to leave, I mean, I think the term has been used somewhere in the past about the left on the cutting room floor.
Right, and I just don't want people to be surprised. And that's not a bad thing. I mean, it's a bad thing because you don't get everything.
But understand also, I mean, I agree with you, but also part of this is that we've tracked every penny on the change order. What was the root cause of the change order?
Right.
I mean, there's a fair amount of this that were things that we, as the district, wanted. That we made changes on. So it could have been, I'm not going to pick on anybody, but it could have been kind of, oh, I didn't think about that. Now that I see this, I'm like, you know, we'd like it. And we've tried to accommodate that where possible. And we've run into some unknown conditions. But yeah, we've had some struggles with documents. And that's why we took a little bit extra time. I think, you know, Dave Spencer could attest to the fact that how much time we took going through their documents. We've done the same thing with Anderson. That was a conscious effort on our part to kind of kick some people in the tail and say, look, we've got to do a better job of looking at some of these things. And we've had some meetings with SSOE. You know, Dave and I have met with Joe Kumpel several times in private about this very thing. We had a meeting recently, I think, with Dr. Heiss and Mr. Furman attended, where we had some issues and concerns with this. But we're pleased with the people here locally, but there's just some things that keep appearing, and I'm kind of tired of having to answer to Bruce Grace and Jack Burr downtown and the building department about some of this.
All right, then the other question I think I know the answer to, but it's good that we all hear it. None of these change orders, none of these additional costs are being, will affect what's going on at Anderson and Turpin.
No, we've not taken money from the pot of one building to put in the pot of the other.
My understanding is, I mean, contingency budgets are for the unknowns, which is what we're dealing with here. We haven't burned through in any one building significant as a total project.
Not as a total project, but as when you're looking at budget for building the fire alarm systems, the suppression systems there, surely pretty well ate up the contingency dollars.
Well, I mean, $110,000 total just tonight for Mabel has to have eaten up a lot of the contingency of Mabel.
Yeah.
Even though I don't know what that contingency is.
Well, we had, you know, probably 3-4% contingency in those fees. You know, for Nagel, we really hadn't gotten into much of it.
before then. These two have taken the bite out of it. But the point is that we have not burned through to the point, as to your point earlier, Julie, that it's going to have a negative impact on any of our future projects.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
No, and we've, a lot of these things went out the bid at the same time. Like I said, we consciously went through, we increased the contingency of the last two bids that we brought to the board before we went out the bid. So to allow for that. So those might be something where there's going to be some of those funds more available, things left on the cutting floor.
Anything else for facilities? Appreciate you taking the time to take us through this, because obviously it's huge, it's important, and it's timely, so thank you. Moving on, item 10, curriculum, Mrs. Adams.
The state of Ohio hasn't officially released our York card, although we've been given preliminary data, and our principals this week, when they meet their staffs, will be sharing the data, so we wanted to share some highlights with you guys today. One of the things I'm just calling on our strategic plan, achieving personal success every day, and passing a test on a Tuesday in the month of May at the very end of the school year are two very different things. However, based on the accountability and how our state measures our success, it's part of our reality. And just to remind you guys, that reality has continued to challenge us because it continues to change. We've had three different assessments in the last three school years, and we are due yet another change in this upcoming spring. And just the timeliness of the data coming back to us and the depth of information is really not what we're used to. First of all, the data was given to us for 2 years ago, just as we were taking current assessments. And as I said, the other data is still coming in. And it's a very high level amount of data. It's test scores, but not necessarily the depth that we need to know item analysis, and where we can really dig in and say, okay, are testing issues, are they related to the curriculum side? Are they more instructional? And so that's just something that's frustrating to us as educators. Just to go into detail a little bit more, that last year's tests, we had a new testing company and format. The rigor of the assessment has changed, and the cut scores have changed. And so due to these changes, school districts all over Ohio, including Forest Hills, are seeing a dip in their results. And we are definitely affected negatively. And so what the state is doing statewide is something called Safe Harbor. And what that means is it's a period of time given to districts to adjust to this new testing situation without giving us any consequences. And that time for Safe Harbor is really expected to extend from 2017 to 2018. So what I want to do today is share some of the highlights of our information, but let you know that we're taking this time period of no consequences in Safe Harbor to really recharge, reflect, and kind of reboot our system so that we can be sure to increase our success. So the highlights where students and staff at Forest Hills really rose to the challenge that we can celebrate is that our performance index remained a B. It's still not exactly where we want it to be, but we maintain that result, and so we're going to continue to focus on that. 100% of our third grade students passed the third grade guarantee, which means they are being promoted on to fourth grade. Our K-3 literacy grade improved a letter grade from a D to a C, and what that tells us is that if we're increasing our numbers of students who are on track kindergarten through third grade to meet the reading requirements. The following subjects in Forest Hills show a score of either 10 to 18 points ahead of where the state expectation is. And so we are proud to say that third grade math, fourth grade math and social studies, sixth grade social studies, eighth grade math and science, high school government, history and biology, and all of the 11th grade assessments, reading, writing, math, and social studies, all show that stronger score above everyone else in the state. And so that's keeping us in the top 20% of school districts in the state. Our gifted score is quite good. Out of 120, it was 116.96. And so our gifted students are achieving at a very high level, which we expect and are proud of. And our graduation is rated as high, 95.8. And so, as you know, we're never going to just kind of rest on where we are. We've got some areas to grow in our gap closing, where we're seeing letter grades we're not proud of and what we want to see increase. And so we are going to, as a district, focus on a couple key things over the course of the next couple months and years to really increase our outcomes. So first, each building is creating a continuous improvement plan that really principals have been working on all summer. They dug deeply into their data, looking for a root cause as to why are these the results we're getting, and building action plans that help address those points. Those key points focus on literacy, they focus on mathematics and numeracy, and they focus on the gap closing. In Forest Hills, we're continuing to see our subgroups grow. It's been very typical that we've had subgroups in the area of students with disabilities, economically disadvantaged, English language learners. But with our latest results, we've expanded and our subgroups have grown to include African American, multiracial, as well as Hispanic. And so that just gives you a sense of the diversity and the changing population in our district and the high accountability that we are held for all of those students. Secondly, across the district, we're going to focus on collaboration, both during the school day and beyond the school day, across department, across grade levels, to make sure that we are pulling all of our resources together to have the most effective outcome for students. And finally, we're going to continue our focus on PBIS, which is a building-wide focus on culture and climate to make sure that there are clear expectations for all students in the building, that there's a consistent messaging to students, and that we're holding all students to a high level of accountability and expectations. And so all of these efforts are challenging for us. And what we're thinking about always is balancing the idea of continuous improvement as we're thinking about innovation, as we're thinking about kind of stretching ourselves and trying creative things that are going to engage our own students and empower them as they achieve high things in Forest Hills. So what you're going to see here over the next couple months is Erica and the team have been working really hard on communicating not only our report card and our achievement scores, but things you'll see in the quality profile, things that our community has said these are important to us, things that involved a strong ACT score. So you're going to see that in Forest Hills, the ACT score is 2.7 points higher than the state. You're going to see that in our AP results that we're still showing strong numbers of students coming out and participating. We're also seeing a large percentage, a little bit higher than 75%, who are performing at 3 or higher, which, you know, it essentially turns into dollars for parents and in the long run. And so we don't want to be stuck on just looking at the external state report card. There's a well-rounded Forest Hills, whether it's Nagel getting the Schools to Watch Award, or Wilson being recognized in the Hall of Fame, or Sherwood being recognized with their PBIS award in the state. Or Turpin, but they're all A award. We have a well-rounded approach, and we want to make sure that our community understands both our report card outcomes and challenges, as well as the whole picture of what we are able to offer in Forest Hills. So look forward soon to a quality profile coming out that details all of the excellence and great things to celebrate in Forest Hills. Are there any questions?
I feel like I'm talking a lot tonight, I'm sorry. I do have one. There are districts there are districts we've compared ourselves to in the past. Are they having similar challenges with the state report card?
They are. It really is happening all over Ohio. I haven't been able to see statewide results because they're not officially released yet. But as we phone call our friends and we're connecting across the states, it is all over the map. You're seeing A's, B's, C's, D's, F's on report cards across the way. And we're all pretty frustrated. Again, it goes back to just not being able to look underneath the hood and see the details of what are the connections, why are our students not performing, and where can we get better. We just don't have enough information yet to draw those conclusions that we can stand behind. So what we've been focusing on really is looking at our internal data, which we see strong results when it comes to MAP, we see strong results when it comes to Aspire, and where we're seeing patterns where that internal data matches up with what the external data is telling us, that's where we know we need to focus. And so we've really taken it, our analysis that deeply, so that we're not chasing our tails every time a new report comes out. We need 3 solid years in a row of consistent testing and results for us to really feel good. And I think that's, again, why the state is offering that safe harbor time, so that all school districts can adjust.
Any other questions?
Sometimes the comparison districts are not very similar is our diversity. That's one of the great things that we have. And when you break that down into the many subgroups that our school district offers services to the students, you see different scores that you like in other school districts that have maybe two or three subgroups versus the number that we have. And so that's a part of the calculation that is not favorable to a school district as large as ours that offers to make services as we do. However, what the continuous improvement plans that Natasha is talking about are isolated for those individual subsets within our buildings. And so our teachers are taking a closer look at the subgroups in their building that we are challenged by, and the subgroups we're doing quite well in, and we're trying to utilize that collaboration time that Natasha talked about to offer suggestions within our own teaching staff on how to improve on all levels. So it's a much bigger, more onion-layered situation here than you might find in some other places. But generally speaking, most districts are struggling with the report card and the analysis of the data that's coming back.
And it's very typical, Julie, you can look at a school that you might compare ourselves to and you can see an A or a B in gap closing, and then you look into the details and you realize they don't have subgroups,
right.
Whereas we have many and they're right. Growing. And so that's a misconception for people at first glance.
Yeah, and you know, I think we generically compare ourselves in the past. It was easier to sort of generically compare ourselves, and I get that. It's layers and digging deeper and all that.
There's two interesting things. Natasha talked to us quite a bit during the curriculum meeting about this. And one, because we're diverse and becoming more diverse, we're going to have, we're going to struggle in some of the areas where we have subgroups where other school districts, maybe when we compared ourselves, maybe we didn't, who are more homogeneous. The other thing that I found particularly interesting is some of these differences have maybe always been out there. They were part of subgroups that we were measuring. And what's interesting is and Natasha, if I say this wrong, please correct me, they are subgroups at the elementary levels because they're a greater percentage within each school, and then they disappear when they get to Nagel because Nagel's bigger. But they're really not gone. They're just not big enough to be part of a subgroup anymore. And I think it's important that we remember that they are there, that they went from the elementary schools to Nagel, and we still need to try to help them.
Well, it's close, what you shared. It's the whole idea that these populations exist, but it might be a little sprinkle here and a sprinkle here. And by the time those sprinkles add up and they get to Nagel, there are 30, and that's when you start getting really accountable. So it looks like, oh, things are not going well as you move up. And then it spreads back out as you split into the two high schools. And so that is a challenge. That's why we have to really work as a system, have these continuous improvement plans, and really be all working together so that that kind of hourglass or disparity that happens is addressed and attended to, even though it might not count at a certain building level.
And here's some of the real good news. Natasha and Mike believe that, and Scott too, believe that our move to all-day kindergarten is going to help us start catching up and solving some of these problems.
Yeah, especially with the early literacy. We're seeing when we compare ourselves to national norms, sometimes we're falling either right at the norm or lower, and that's not typical for Forest Hill. So we really believe being able to attract those kids in, spend more time with them, with their needs, will truly make a difference and just give us a stronger base to begin.
That's a great point.
I hear complaints all the time at the state level where people are saying, to your point earlier, we need some consistency. The referees change the game constantly. Matter of fact, one year they changed the rules in the middle of the game. So that does make it hard to try and win the game. But, are you going to say something?
No, I was just going to say, out of respect for time, I'm going to mail in my curriculum report as Natasha just gave it. pretty much she nailed it, not Jim. I mean, it's so thank you very much.
Well, so the plan for the future in regard to this is something that Natasha said that I think is extremely important, and that is affording our teachers opportunity in professional learning communities and organize collaborative efforts so that we are more flexible and more adaptable because of the work that our teachers are doing, and we certainly are not being directed by an assessment that happens once a year. we're being directed by what we know is the best instructional practice that we can put in our classrooms that offers the best opportunities for students, that starts with teachers collaborating together about student performance and what they can do instructionally to address the concerns that they have, in addition to adding value to those places that we are doing quite well. And that is a different look in the transition from a new age of education. That is less about testing, and that is more about differentiation in the classroom. That is more about that student-centered discussion we had about 2 hours ago now. And that's where we need to be, in my opinion, and that's what the leaders across the country are suggesting. And so when you take a closer look at the roadmap that we were talking about earlier, we're going to see more opportunities for teachers to get together to talk about instruction, talk about student performance, and really talk about student learning and not so much about teachers teaching. And that is a big transformation in education that needs to happen. Exciting, very exciting work at 9:15 for all the time, but it is monumental work.
Moving on, human resources, Mrs. Carmichael.
Item 11.1, A, retirement. We do have three folks there who are going to be retiring. Total 68 years there, so we would like to say congratulations and wish them well in retirement. A couple of those are effective now, and if one there is effective at the end of this calendar year. Item B, we have resignations. Item C, these are resignations of supplemental contracts. Item D, change of assignment for the 16-17 year. I will point out the second item there, Mary Beth Conklin, is a 0.5 to 1.0 kindergarten teacher. That's adding that fourth section of kindergarten at AR Elementary. Mr. Hartman has extended his thanks to the board and superintendent for that. Moving on to E, change of salary. Those are a couple of corrections. Item F just covers GHI, J, and K. Just our normal language there. Item G, appointments. And we do have a couple of our administrators here. I'd like to introduce them. Emily Bamber is not here this evening. Mabel had an activity, and they needed all hands on deck. She is coming to us from Lakota as an assistant principal at Mabel. Joy O'Brien is here. Joy has been at Mercer this past year as a sixth grade teacher. At the very, very last minute, we had a very late resignation, and she jumped right in, and we're very pleased that she is joining our administrative team this year. We also have Kim Pence here, and Kim is coming from Princeton, where she was also with the special education programs coordinator there, and we're also very pleased to have Kim on board. Certified staff, you do see several teachers there at the bottom of page 2 and the top of page 3. We will invite the new teachers to the September board meeting, as we have done the last 2 years, just to say hello to you. You also see classified staff, paraprofessionals, as well as additional support personnel. Continuing on, item on page 3 to the top of page 4, where we have item H, special services appointments. And these just finish up the 15-16 school year. Item I, these are special services appointments for the 16-17 school year. Take a moment to look at those. I would like to point out about halfway on page 5, you'll see Ohio School Counselor Evaluation System, OSCIS training, and this is a new state mandate. Our counselors, school counselors, are now going to be evaluated in a very similar fashion as to our teachers who are part of the Ohio Teacher Evaluation System and our principals who are part of the Ohio Principal Evaluation System. So just to let you know, that is a new mandate. Item J, if you look on page 6 and 7, you will see a number of coaches and advisors. Item K, substitute personnel. You see drivers, administrative assistant, paraprofessional. I would like to point out the administrator. One of our, Sherwood, assistant principal, is out for a couple of months. And Nathan Lynch is going to be filling in and doing some work there part-time with Dan. And this is a partnership with Great Oaks. Nathan is actually an employee of Great Oaks, working in Anderson, and they were very kind to allow us to utilize his services for part of the day. Item L is a job description for an HVAC engineer. And item M is a supplemental salary schedule with a couple of just very small revisions. Did work through these with our FHTA group. And so since the regular board meeting, the staffing remains 790.98. And just a reminder, in the October board meeting, do a final counting of all the changes from 15-16 to 16-17 school year. The superintendent recommends that the board approve the personnel items as listed.
Any questions? Consent agenda, so we'll move on to item 12, student services. Mr. Bryan.
Item 12.1 is a motion to approve the services agreement between Central Ohio Medical Review and the Forest Hills School District. This is based on recent legislation over the course of the last year regarding all school districts in the state of Ohio to have a physician or nurse practitioner consult, provide a medical review, and conduct referrals for all of our eligible special education students who receive related services, such as occupational therapy, physical therapy, nursing services, and those kinds of services or therapies. This is a service agreement that may be terminated in the near future. We just received notice today that an amendment is coming through or has been proposed that may allow the option of school districts to have our own providers conduct these reviews. So it has been recommended we still have this approved at this time, but we will be on hold from this point further if an extension is granted for this to wait for this amendment to occur. 12.2 is a foreign exchange student from Turpin High School. We are recommending that Olivia Drenzla from Germany will be a student at Turpin High School. Council on International Educational Exchange is sponsoring her, and all board policy information that has been required has been received and reviewed.
Any questions? Thank you very much. Moving on to technology, Mr. McCormick.
Item 13.1 is Schoology, our learning management system. Most of you have experienced it. It's our course management system that all students use within the districts as well as staff. So the superintendent recommends that the board approve the Schoology Master Services Renewal Agreement in the amount of $8,250. Item 13.2 is My Learning Plan. It's been in our district for approximately 5 to 6 years, provided by County Lipowich. It allows our staff members to request professional development and give some additional details about that, track their progress, logs, etc. The superintendent recommends that the board approve My Learning Plan, Frontline Professional Growth, Customer Agreement, in the amount of $9,959.25.
Any questions? Thank you very much. Moving on to Treasurer's Report, Mr. Tepler.
Item 14 is an item the board approved originally back in April. It's the tax rate set amounts for 2017. The reason we're bringing it back is that based on the tax revenue that's been collected, the payments that have been made, we are in a position to actually pay off the payroll bond millage 3 years early. The original millage was 2.21. Property values have increased. It's now been reduced to 1.69. And the collections that we'll have this fall will be a little bit more than we need to actually pay the remaining 3 years of the debt. So it's a good story. We've how that's happened is we've taken, for the last 20 plus years, taken a percent of the TIF money that represents the bond percent and actually pay the bond debt. Not required to do, but it's the right thing to do in our minds. So it's just tax revenue like any other tax revenue. So we use it to pay the bond debt. So, the tax bills that are received in January will be, 1.69 mils reduced. The only bond millage will be the 4.45 that was just approved. Where that puts us is still right in the middle of those 60-something districts in the four-county area. We're not extremely high. We're right in the middle when it comes to bond or capital debt. good story. Hopefully we'll share them with the community in a couple different ways as it rolls out, but it's, it won't be hitting anybody until January, but we get the rates approved. So I recommend the board adopt the resolution accepting these revised amounts and rates as determined by the Budget Commission of Hamilton County and authorizing the necessary tax levies and certified them to the county auditor.
Questions on that?
I have a question.
Okay.
So if I'm a taxpayer and I really don't follow the schools closely and I get my bill, it's reduced for Nagle, but for the first time, they're paying on the bond issue or no?
The tax bill they receive, you get your tax bill in January, you will pay less. You will pay approximately $50 less.
That's what I mean, the practical effect. And I know I said it very well, the practical effect is you will have.
Roughly $32 per mil, so if we take the mil times 1.69, it's roughly over $50 per 100,000, absolutely reduced, real dollars reduced. Now, there'll be some other things that hit that are approved potentially by our voters that are not school related that will make your tax bill whatever it's going to be. So that's why we have to take an active approach and let people know that our piece is lower.
But
to be clear,
next year.
This our current bond is already in the bill, and so when they, that is taken away, it truly will be
a reduction
in bond money. But again, as he points out, who knows what will happen to the bill.
I should know this, but the bond has been in the bill for a year now. How long has it been in the bill?
Yes.
2 years? This will be the second year? Okay.
So, good story, and obviously, you know, something
that's actually a great story, but we'll talk more about that later.
And then item 14.2, we have donations for July, over $1,500 from our partners. The State Reporting Towns, we do this the time of year when we're just now getting the information on Title I and IDEA funding. So we have six funds that are negative, but we have outstanding requests to cover those as well as general fund coverage of that. Item C is a summary of general fund receipts. We would this early in the fiscal year, we received a significant amount of our tax revenue. And D&E kind of showed the expenditures, we're still early in the game, but only 7.3% of our appropriations have been spent, pretty much close to our average. F1 bank reconciliation, G investments, and H, there's a significant increase in appropriations as we did receive our funding levels. IDEA and Title I mainly, but over $2.2 million of increased appropriations. Item I, we have our board service fund expenses. We're asking for approval. Requesting, and this is just more of a clarification. Many years ago, the board approved pay to play one of the sports, if you will, the activity was marching band was on that list. Fits better as a course fee, so that board approved that as a course fee last month, but we wanted to take it, so we're taking that off the pay-to-play list. It's now a course fee. So that's item J. Item K is an annual transfer to the self-insured workers' comp fund that we fund from general fund dollars. Another part of K is a transfer, something else the board approved, I think in June, having the, we're transferring Anderson turf fields into a district turf fund. That way we will fund whatever turf needs, replacement needs we have, but we need to transfer to actually do that. So that's what those two items in K. And then now we're asking the board to approve the list of building cashiers for the 16-17 school year, which is an annual approval. So we recommend the board approve this report as well as items 9.1 through 14.2.
I move that we approve items 9.1.
Second. Any questions or discussion? Please call the roll.
Mr. Pruitt?
Yes.
Mr. Wright?
Yes.
Mr. Bissinger?
Yes.
Mr. Hemmelgarn?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes. Now moving on to reports to the board. First one that I have up is the athletics curriculum and student services committee report.
I meant what I said before. Jim, I don't know if you have anything to add, Jim, but I have the notes. I have. It was very informational. I learned a lot, speaking for myself, so good background, performance standards, planning to address the gap students. I have that down in those subgroups, good sense of the data, which is ever-changing, and the collaboration we're using to attack our subgroups and the gap and that. So I think all of us
heard that from Natasha and Jim and Scott a few minutes ago, so. Anything else?
Thank you. Moving on, 15-2, Business Advisory Committee report.
We will start a new group on 9-8-7-5. That was the first meeting of last year.
Thank you. Moving on, 15-3, Communications and Policy Committee report. Mrs. Bissinger on the first meeting.
This is actually the second reading of the policies that we brought to you last month concerning public records and standard-based school counselor evaluation. Public records, you'll recall, we reduced the actual amount of charging people. These were kind and gentle. And then we are making our school counselor evaluation sort of along with what we're doing with teachers and principals as well.
Oh, that's the second reading, so that's an action item, correct?
It is.
Well, we have a motion to approve. Yes.
I move that we approve the public records and standard-based school counselor evaluation policies.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion or questions? Mr. Steffer?
Mrs. Bissinger?
Yes.
Mr. Hellebarn?
Yes.
Mr. Fruman?
Yes.
Dr. Heiss?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes. The second one, for the policy committee, we met on August 15th, and at that point we had just two things to cover. One was the wireless communication devices policy, and the second was student network and internet acceptable use and safety policy. The second one was just bringing it up to standards. We are going to conform to whatever the NEOLA standard language is. The first one was, quite frankly, bringing our, I'll call it our cell phone policy, up to reality of what was really occurring. Our current policy indicates that they're not to have phones out, and that's not reality. They're using smartphones in the education process, and so we've adapted the language to what reality is currently. Did I say that correctly? I thought I saw some concern. Okay. That's the first reading. The language is in your board docs, and like I said, it's pretty straightforward, but it does bring our cell phone policy up to reality. For any questions, happy to address them. Moving on, let's see, where are we?
Question for the Business Advisory Committee is on the 8th, that's a Thursday.
Thursday, yes.
7 o'clock.
7 o'clock. The board office, yes.
Forest Hills Foundation report.
The foundation met on August 3rd, 2016, and I'll give you the highlights. The treasurer reported that for 15-16, the foundation raised $130,100, which is really awesome. There was a guest presentation concerning Naviance by Pam Tackett, who happens to be a Marymount counselor and is married to one of the members of the foundation. And what Naviance is, it's a one-stop shop for all college needs. It's web-based. To help kids and parents alike. It also has a component for students that are interested in non-college futures. There's a huge career piece to it. The reasons that, I mean, the presentation was very long and involved and very educational. The reasons they did it was it's a place to send parents and kids one-stop shopping, like I said. So we're looking into that to see if that's something we want to do, and I believe the foundation is interested in helping with that. Their alumni engagement reported 62 golfers in the community golf outing on July 23rd, raising $3,000. The distinguished alumni committee met to select this year's honorees who are being notified. The event is October 14th, 2016 at Ivy Mills Country Club. Community outreach, there's an all-in community give back planning, community give back week scheduled for the week of October the 10th through the 14th. That's where a week up to the Truman Anderson game, where we have a donations drive to, last year it was to benefit inter-parish ministries in Newtown. Each school gave all week the football game, and then you could get it again as well. Under the program initiative committee, Grant Committee has chosen this year's winners, and they will be announced at opening day this Friday. Executive Director's report, the big news was the soiree date change to now September 24th at Anderson Mercy. You can go on the website if you want to sign up, and I believe hard copies of invitations went out this past week. And
The next meeting is September the 4th.
Thank you. Any questions? Anything to add? Moving on to legislative liaison report. The ESSA, which is the federal government reauthorization of ESEA, continues to get a lot of attention in Ohio. Since the feds turned over a lot of authority back to the states, there's a local input session on September 29th at 5:30 at the Cincinnati-Hamilton County Action Agency. There's also a ESSA webinar that Ohio Department of Education is putting on 8/24 if you just can't get enough ESSA. And the third event that's occurring is a regional legislative breakfast on September 27th at Butler Tech. Right now the legislature is out of session and they will be until after the election, but I was at some session OSBA put on and they said when they come back, I think the comment was watch out. Because there are a number of things that are still in the back burner that could get pulled to the front burner, and we'll get into those some other time. But anyway, that's all I have. Moving on to Forest Hills Teachers Association report. Mrs. Lauer.
I offer a reprieve. As I come forward, I was sitting here going, oh my gosh, I'll try to be quick and to the point. And being last on Thursday with the walking, you guys have done an outstanding job. First of all, I just wanted to say, wow, today's our first day as the staff to officially be back in the district, and I believe everybody's here in good spirit and in mind. The weather was outstanding today, so I'm sure that added to some nice opportunities for us all to start school today. It was a great coat, it wasn't too hot, and with all the changes in the buildings and so forth, I know the staff is really to getting back to school. This week's great. We're having our professional development all strategically placed in the first week. However, I will tell you for every teacher, the most important day is next Monday. So we're all lucky to get the best that opportunity. Tonight's report, I condensed this a little bit, and I'm going to push it down into two main aspects from the association, which is, first we want to talk about strategic plan, and two is our state OEA goals and agenda to kind of reinforce some of the state on opportunities. And with that being said, we want to acknowledge and endorse the strategic vision presented this evening as well, and being a part of that opportunity and how we process that was really amazing. I think the biggest thing from my intake is how we're hearing from our community. And they did a nice job of keeping us stable in the words and the things that we said to make sure that the words that we used were words that the public would understand. And be able to put that into place. And I think the people that presented tonight did a great job. And I will say, you know, we spent many, many hours on that. Scott and his administrative team, as well as those of us that were present, we really put a lot of time and energy. So I really just want to encourage the board to commit on moving us forward. That plan alone will help guide the association as well as the staff as we continue to make progress. The second one are just some ideas. I know Randy, you mentioned this, and I always try to endorse that for my teachers group as we move forward. OEA and our agenda is here with the association and the state. With the passage of Every Student Success Act, public educators have a goal regardless of the success of a school. So when those laws are passed and put in place, we don't necessarily look at successful schools or failing schools. It's there to succeed for all students. And that's a goal regardless of where we're at. For us in Forest Hills, our public school system faces competition for public dollars from charter schools, criticism from private school and corporate reform advocates, a continuous struggle for funding at the state and local level. How we respond to those challenges and how we tell our story of tremendous achievements in public schools will determine the future of our school here in Forest Hills, as well as many Ohio schools' future. But that means that since using the state of the FHTA organization would like to offer collaboration efforts to communicate and often extend support for public education. What I mean by that is, here in Forest Hills, a lot of times we discuss the things that we can't work together on, things we can't change, and things that we just need to be able to move forward on. With that, I also know that we also have those of us who are really involved at the state level, and on our district here, we're very fortunate. We have people that are moving into those state positions, Mr. Smith and Mr. Broadwater. While this is true here, not always being able to change what's there, we also have a public voice and have a responsibility as a great school system to advocate for public education and to move that kind of change that needs to happen whether it be funding, whether it be legislation, whether it be testing, whether it be in how we treat subgroups of students with disabilities, I think our school has a lot of voice. Working with the legislative liaison, of course, the school district, as well as the association, we can endorse and support public education services. I'd like to see us be a little bit more proactive and being able to voice for our outstanding schools in the state of Ohio, setting that trend. I know that in the past we've had a lot of work with legislative aspects, and it would be great to see us move forward in that this school year as we move ahead. So I thank you for your time.
Thank you for your report. Thank you for your support. That brings us to the close. We will have an executive session.
Pursuant to Ohio Revised Code Section 121.22G1, I hereby move to adjourn to executive session for the purpose of considering the deployment, employment, dismissal, discipline, promotion, demotion, or compensation of a public employee or official.
Second.
Stepper.
Dr. Rice?
Yes.
Mr. Pruitt?
Yes.
Mr. Fissinger?
Yes.
Mr. Helmelmar?
Yes.
Mr. Smith?
Yes. Well, I thank everybody for your patience this evening. We went through a lot of important topics. I will say that we will see probably many of you on Friday at the convocation at Turpin High School. At what time? 7:30. Okay. Thank you all very much. We do not expect to take action when we come back from executive session. Good evening.